Hello everyone. Welcome to the second part of the three-part talk series, Doing Site Reliability Engineering the Right Way by Piyush Verma. Thank you for attending this session. We'll be starting off now. A little bit about me. I'll be your moderator for the evening, Saurabh Hirani. I'm working in the operations team at Autodesk. I'm basically your typical Linux guy who still fondly remembers the last time he ran FSCK. It's been a long time. I'm moderating this session because, like some of you, I too am searching for an answer to that question. Who am I? Am I a DevOps guy, an SRE, or a sysadmin who just knows how to code? I found the answers to some of those questions in the previous session, and I'm sure I'll learn a few more in this session. And to conduct this session, we have the inimitable Piyush Verma with us, CTO of Last9.io. The first part of the series laid the foundation for the need of an SRE team and the benefits that it brings to an org. And in this session, Piyush will be building upon that, and he'll be sharing his hard-earned knowledge and experience around the approach, choices, and trade-offs that SREs must make when choosing the right tools in their trade. And I'm sure that you will get your time's worth. I know I will, and walk away with useful, actionable insights. Now, before I hand over to Piyush, just a few simple guidelines. The audience can ask questions both during or after the session. Please click on the Q&A feature of Zoom and paste your question, and I'll try to communicate them to Piyush whenever possible. This event is being live streamed. Some of the participants are there on YouTube also. So, check it out. If at all you can't forward the Zoom invite, please forward the YouTube invite to your friends. And the slides used in this session will be posted by Piyush later. They will be made available. And lastly, please do not switch off your phones. Some of you might be on call, and it would be really ironical if you miss a pager duty alert while attending a session which talks about doing SRE the right way. So, all right then, all over to you, Piyush. All the best.
Thanks. Hope my Wi-Fi holds through this time around. Yeah. So this second part is about understanding the mindset and the tools. You know, like part one was more about setting up a culture of why SRE is different from DevOps. I'll try to go in slightly into the depths of what does it be like being on call, what tools and what mindset do we use. I think I've already been introduced, so I don't need to do that. Few frequently asked questions that I get faced, you know, like which one is better? Is Terraform better? Is Automatic better? Should I go Kubernetes all the way to deploy my YAMLs, or should I actually use Ansible? Or sometimes, you know, or even to an extent where Kubernetes coming in, with serverless coming in, is the right way to go? And also one of the oldest existent choices of codeless, you know, like where you can actually generate code using YAML, is that the right way? There was a point of time I used to believe that the answers to these will get me closer to reliability and things will begin to fail less. But the bigger question that we want to ask ourselves is, when something fails or does it break, does it make a sound? How else would you know? So if I go step by step, will this make a sound when it breaks? Would this make a sound when it breaks? Or would this make a sound when it breaks? For a moment, I want to take this as well. This is a simple piece of code. I'm running something. Will this make a sound when it breaks? I think it's time for probably asking audience this question. You know, like, why don't you just take a quick poll and tell me, would there be a sound when any of this system breaks?
Everyone in the call, there is a poll button in your Zoom link. Just click on that, and there is the first poll that has come up. Would this make a sound when it breaks? Yes or no? Just click on whatever answer you feel is right, and go ahead and submit. Launching the poll.
There'll be a bunch of these polls during the talk. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. We see people answering.
All right. But that's a decent choice. Some of them say yes, some of them say no. Okay, fair enough. Still coming in. I think a few more seconds and we can halt this. Yeah, fair enough. Let's stop that. So, pretty interestingly, 64% people said that, you know, it should make a sound, and 37% had said that it doesn't make a sound, it should not make a sound. You know the answer to this question? I'm going to go back slightly towards a bit into one of the famous questions that psychology has ever asked us. If a tree falls in a forest and no one is around to hear it, does it make a sound? Similar question. If a bug happens and no user is around to see it, should it raise an alert? You know, that's the more important question to ask. So more often than not, what happens is that we get carried away or paged into attending every issue as a priority. Is it really a priority? Is it something that should be addressed? There's a lot of economics of reliability that goes behind it. What if I said that this bug was actually in a logout button at 4 a.m.? Should it make a sound right now? Well, probably not. It also depends on how frequently is it occurring. It's never just a plain black and white question of there's an error, you got to rush towards it. At the same time, I'm also not saying that be careless about it. Regardless, this is exactly what leads to a lot of what we call as post-bug stress. We get paged. Now what do we do? Now how do we go about it? There's a small incident that I'll walk you through, a journey of an incident, which was one of the most remarkable ones that I had gone through. And this incident was typically everything in place and in order, and yet something falls through the cracks. So it was around 7:30 a.m., almost 25 hours before a country launch that we were doing, the pager duty went off. You know, and they were... all our buses started going on that something's breaking. We went in, we searched Elasticsearch. There were just 500 requests were there, 5xx. We start debugging what's going on. There were a lot of logs coming in around at 1 Mbps. There wasn't a correlation ID so that we could actually isolate between the tons of logs where the exact issue is happening. Precisely 5 minutes later, 500 stopped. Pager duty is auto-resolved. We're like, fine, must be something, not something very high priority. We can come back at this later. 5 minutes later, exactly sharp by the clock, Pingdom starts alerting pager duty again that public API is unreachable. Every time in the you see a red font, I'm basically trying to introduce a new tool here that most of the tools that we could think of are already there. There's Grafana as well, which has been set up. That also sets up pager duty for some 500 requests. Alerts are going to Sentry, which also triggers pager duty. Elasticsearch, Elastalert, Sentry, standard route goes in. Goes on. 7:45, exactly 5 minutes later, 500 stop. Pager duty is auto-resolved again. And this cycle is repeating. 5 minutes on, 5 minutes off. 5 minutes on, 5 minutes off. When these systems fail, the very first thing that we ask ourselves is, was there a deployment that had happened? I mean, quite obviously, because that may be the easiest answer, because more often than not that we say that most bugs lie between the computer and the chair, and which is obviously as somebody must have done a deployment. So we go in and actually check our run deck. There wasn't a deployment. Looks good. We call up the release manager, actually physical call. Was it a new deployment? So either lies or doesn't acknowledge, but there wasn't a deployment. Am I still on the call? Is my internet holding through?
Yeah, all good.
Okay, perfect, good. So we call up the on-call SRE. Was there a change? The last on-call SRE, there wasn't a change. So Grafana looks okay. Sentry looks, doing their job. Prometheus doing okay. APM doing okay. Where exactly is the bug? We don't know. We check firewall. Is this dropping any traffic? No, it doesn't drop any traffic. This whole ordeal, believe it or not, took us 20 hours. And 20 hours later, we realized that there was a simple mount command which hadn't run on one of the DB shards. And because of which, data was being written in memory. The system got rebooted, data was wiped. Now, this machine wasn't supposed to be commissioned, but we had fixed the machine, so we put it into circulation. Service Discovery brought it up. DB shard, one of the commands did not run via Ansible as it should have. So one machine was left out, one command did not run, the machine rebooted, data gone, only a certain section of the data is gone. What that means is that a certain type of request only started failing, which would actually disconnect the load balancer as an unhealthy upstream, and that's why the circulation went there. Bigger question here is, we figured it out. What is the next step of this? Quite obviously, the next step is, well, you fix this, true, but the more important question that we have while being on call is, where else is this failing? How do we avoid this? These are the two important questions that we actually learned in part one as well, that this is what gets my curiosity going. Whenever I see a bug, my first reaction is, where else is this failing? Because systems are designed by culture. If I've done a mistake at one place, it's quite obvious I would have done it at some other place as well. And the second thing is, like, really going to the bottom of it. How am I going to avoid this situation ever from happening again? So to avoid a situation from happening again, we must know what the root cause of the problem is. What would be the root cause in this case?
Okay. So I've raised a poll again for the same.
What do you think could have been the resolution? You know, like, should we, would the root cause, do we say that, hey, use Chef, use Ansible, use Kubernetes, use Terraform, or nothing that we could do?
So audience member, you can check the poll and you can put in your results.
It's interesting. When you say nothing you could do, you mean nothing I could do or nothing one could do? So. Cool. Let's just give it 10 more seconds and then we can actually do it. Cool. I think we can stop the poll.
Yeah. Let us share the results.
I would encourage everybody to vote. So, oh, interesting. 80% people say that there is nothing you could do. 10% actually say that Ansible. Well, the reason, so it was actually Ansible's wrongdoing. So because we used to run Ansible, it would run commands, but a machine was brought into circulation. And when it was brought into circulation, one of the Ansible runs hadn't run on that because it was a newly provisioned machine, but Service Discovery picked it up. Use Kubernetes, well, exactly what happened, we were using Nomad at that point of time. And because the machines are available, it's dynamic load, it would just go on to any one of the machines. So I would say actually these were, if I had gone really old school and not used any of these, maybe would have avoided the other. But nothing you could do. Sure, but you know, business won't take that as an answer. You know, like, how do we really solve this? I mean, we can't end an RC. This is what goes into building a good root cause analysis. A root cause analysis must identify what is it exact, what was the loss of this? You know, if the loss of this was data loss, which resulted in actually a significant amount of, you know, like you would say embarrassment, if not a financial loss, which we would not have been measured because the system was actually down. There has to be something to avoid this. It can't end that, look, sorry boys, we can't do anything about it. So there has to be something. To understand root cause, one of the important questions we must ask ourselves is, what are the reasons why things fail? Because only then we can identify that, hey, this is the category in which this had failed. So if I was to raise a couple of choices here, you know, like failure reasons. So this is almost shamelessly from Google's SRE book as well, and also a lot of other study that has happened. There are a few choices in classification why we say that, hey, failure reasons of, yeah, they can let the poll on.
Yeah.
You can let the poll on. People can actually answer that. So the question here is, in what ways do systems fail? This is a summation of most of the broad categories. The bigger question is, What do you think is the single most prominent, or maybe pick two, you know, like pick multiple choices. What do you think are the reasons why which software fails? New
Those small
deployment could
bitcoin.
be anything. Yeah, incorrect expectation is obviously, I mean, that usually comes in from I expected some it to do something, but that's not really a like is interesting. Network failure, traffic load is throughput increasing, sudden surge spike, etc. Service provider fault would cover everything starting from your ISP failing or AWS failing, etc. I encourage the rest of the five people to vote as well. Okay, cool. I think 5 more seconds, we can stop the poll.
Sure.
Interesting.
All right.
Let's look at the results. Sweet. So majority of you believe that configuration change and new deployment are the biggest cause of failures. Actually, that's right. Those are the single most reasons why things fail. And this goes back into our talk one, you know. Reliability is a constant challenge between stability and release. Our first principle that we follow is how do we increase the velocity of other teams to ship more and more software? And when that happens is when bugs happen. But we have to avoid those as well. So these are the reasons why failure happened, right? But interestingly, I want to raise a point here. We never say failures happen because of individuals, right? But more often than not, when root cause analysis come out, which is also coined as RCA, hopefully there's no Raghu on the call, we end up mentioning this. Raghu forgot to execute a mount command. If we go back, right, we say that, look, individuals are not the reasons. Reasons are these. So the RCA cannot actually say that an individual failed to do something. It has to be something else. So how do we improve this RCA? We take another stab at it. We say that, look, infrastructure team forgot to execute mount command, but it's not really actionable. Like somebody forgot how, like, is the resolution that we're going to boost their memory? That's not possible, right? So this RCA doesn't really have an actionable in it. Yes, it does summarize the situation well. It's blameless, as HCP folks like to call it, but it's not really actionable here. So what's the actionable? Is it the right question to ask, why is it possible to SSH? So we should not allow to SSH, but that's really hindering the work, right? There's a reliability team who is in charge of the system. There's a deployment team, there's a DevOps team, all put together. They're system administrator. They are going to SSH into the system. So that's not the answer. You know, one thing that I tell, and a lot of time we ask ourselves, what is the best way to actually put security? It's not logs, it's security cameras. Logs can be broken, they can be avoided, but security cameras are capturing it. The fear of being observed is actually the biggest. Now, in this case, we're not distilling fear here, but what you're saying is that preventing somebody from doing their job is not going to make system reliable. So this RCA probably also, it asks the right question, but probably is not the right resolution. It's only going to hamper other things. We take another stab at it. Maybe this is the right question to ask. Why don't we have a tool which actually matches and alerts on a configuration mismatch? If all my systems in production had a way to match their configurations and raise an error every time there was a mismatch, that would be the best thing, right? Because now people are free to do, are not burdened, and also can actually take their decisions more freely because the mundane work of having to validate a configuration has been offloaded to a computer because of this underlying principle. Very simple. We've read this over and over. To us, human failures are inevitable. As long as there are humans in charge of system, they are going to make mistakes. That takes us to another question here. Do you think changing personnel or people in charge would have changed anything in this overall situation? You know, that's the bad apple theory, right? Bad apple theory says that you take out a bad apple of a basket, what remains is really good quality apples. So What we're saying is that there was a person who could have been in charge, which replaced them, and what we get is a better result. Would that solve the problem? We wait for the poll results.
Everyone else on the call, please. Okay, we have a good number.
Yeah, good that the polls are anonymous. Saurav, are you polling as well?
No, as a panelist, I can't.
Okay. Cool, let's just give it 5 more seconds. Cool.
Okay, sharing results.
So, 80% people think, oh, that's like Pareto thinking. 80% think it's not going to solve it, 20% think it's going to solve it. We can apply the 80-20 rule. So, but here's the thing, skill and ownership. One of the most important things. I would say that it really depends again. You know, like I won't say that either of you are right here, but nor are you wrong. Because while we say that, look, personal changing doesn't really solve anything, but at the same time, we have to be pragmatic and cognizant of the fact that skill and ownership always go hand in hand. What that means is not less skill. It always means somebody who doesn't have a real passion or is not really somebody who's not really a guy who has had or girl who has handled reliability.
Yeah. Sorry to interrupt. I think some of the attendees on Zoom cannot see the poll results. So it would help if you could call out the numbers.
Oh, okay. All right. So 80% of the people think that changing personal will not change anything. 20% think that changing a personal might affect something, might improve things. So skill and ownership are something which go hand in hand. You have to have the right skilled people. You have to give them the right ownership as well. Once this goes in a balance, mistakes are going to happen as well. You know, like at that point, you basically take a start and okay, look, I got almost the best here. But it doesn't mean it's going to eliminate the mistakes forever. So we need to go back to finding the real root causes and actually improving by putting technology in the place of doing these mundane tasks. And this is exactly what an SRE does. As our goal, what should our tools look like? These are the tools which basically catch these minutest of the details of what exactly can a person overlook and miss. What is so mundane that it becomes boring that is going to result in an error? So here's the thing, anything that you're not paying attention to is going to fail at some point or the other. And that is where these tools actually come in really handy. So if I take a stab again at what's the real root cause here, this is the real root cause. If you could isolate it down, system configuration validator was absent. There was not really a system which was actually validating the state of the machines every now and then. And we built it. And when we built it, we started realizing it became one of our bread and butter tools. Before, after launches, we actually started running those configuration validators to see if everything looked okay. If all ports could actually scan all machines, if the connectivity was fine. I mean, obviously, the scope kept increasing. And this is really what we did. One of the greatest tools that fit here is OS Query. That is a great tool by Facebook. You can actually make SQL queries to systems. You can match them across systems and see which one's working well, where is the difference, etc. Start introducing those tools. Introducing failure mode effect analysis. This is a slightly older term, FMEA. This is borrowed from the industrial sector, which what we call as these days is chaos engineering. Failure mode effect analysis basically talks about you run an application in a failure mode and you see what is the impact of it. Now, if in our lab, in our systems, if we would have actually run these systems against failure scenarios, fault injection techniques, we could have caught some of these. Again, we're not saying that failures will be eliminated. We're saying that failures will be reduced. Another thing that was missing was non-latent configuration validator. So there's a lot of research that actually went around. There's a lot of good research papers as well, which classify configurations as latent and non-latent. And what they realized was that around, if I quote the number correctly, around 72% of the failures could have been reduced if configuration validation was not latent. What that means is usually more often than not in our code bases, we want to write to a file, we want to read from a directory, we want to hit a URL. this configuration variable while it is passed through the system, but the code point that actually uses it, the invocation happens very late. What that means is, if it was a bad URL, after my application has been deployed and has been running for a while, only when that code point code path is hit is when that validation will happen, or whether it is correct or not. So they say, bring it back at the start of the configuration of system startup, validate every single configuration variable that is there, and you may be able to reduce your failures by 77%. One of the techniques, not the only technique. These three we identified as root cause of this situation. And when we did this, we realized that the same bug we actually did not. When I say same bug, similar issues also, we did not catch again. So one could say maybe the bug never happened again, or maybe our techniques ensured that we don't run into those issues again. So coming back to the same question.
We have a question from the audience.
Yes.
The question is that, does bad apple theory contradict blameless RCA? Wouldn't it lead to blame-driven witch hunts after each incident occurs?
It doesn't, because what we are technically saying is I'm not an advocate of bad apple theory. I'm an advocate of balancing skill and ownership. What I mean, so that's the point that I want to rather focus on. What that means is, if I have a reliability team, but they don't have the right authority or the ownership to actually call off a deployment, it's going to result in an issue. So don't call out names. Ensure that there is enough ownership resting with the right skilled people. And also ensure that you invest in those skills as well, because that's the balance that needs to be maintained, which is what the whole idea of this point was. More than happy to actually discuss that in detail at the end of the call if we still have a remainder of a question around.
Sure.
But does that address?
I think it does. It does fall out to the subject. In case there is further elaboration needed, could you please call out that question again at the end of the session, please? Thank you.
Coming back to the same curiosity, same two questions. Where else is this failing and how do we avoid this? This was an avoidance that we did by actually writing a very good RCA. I mean, good in terms of its qualitative, but as we saw a result that we didn't hit the same bug again or similar bug again. So maybe it was working. But how do we actually move this towards, we want to eliminate such failures from happening again. More often than not, I've actually seen in the industry that we move towards the direction of more managers. More managers doesn't mean less failures. Why? Because more managers are more people. We just established that if there are people, there are going to be bugs. More number of people doesn't really amplify my stability. If anything, if we say that it's 0.6% stable because of a person, 0.6 multiplied by 0.6, it totally becomes 0.36. It won't add up. Does that mean that more processes are going to introduce less failures? No. Like the simple question that we ask ourselves, do we disallow SSH? That's not really going to solve the problem, because these processes are probably going to slow you down. They will require more approvals, authentications, which are going to result in more failures and not less failures for sure. So what leads to less failures? One of the biggest things that leads to less failures is this curiosity. Curiosity to ask this question. While I'm sitting idle, while there's a downtime in terms of my downtime, not the system downtime, while I'm actually, I don't have an active bug to chase, but I'm on call. This curiosity of asking myself, can I run a prototype of this? Can I actually deliberately inject faults into my system, which is a precursor of failure mode effect analysis, goes back into the same theory, or as we call chaos engineering. Can I actually take this application, try to break this in as many possible ways and actually record that down? And I think I should have posted a screenshot of one of the FMEAs that we used to do. Do remind me at the along the slides, I'll actually ensure that when I distribute the slides out, I'll add a photo there. We started running our applications against detailed failures. Take the disks out. In a cluster mode, actually bring a node down. See how long does it take for the cluster to actually sync back. See, also check how long does it take for the application to talk to the database in case the database was not reachable, or in case of non-cluster, in case of a master slave, how long does it really take for the slave to get promoted? is there any data loss between those situations? If we record these down, the answer that we get is, look, this is the impact that is going to have. And then we can measure an impact because there's a cost to improve as well. And this is what leads to lesser failures. Next one of the techniques is standardization leads to less failures. This is where I really, really encourage everything as code, infrastructure as code, policies as code. And what I mean by code is not just mere configuration, really well designed code. You know, like I was having this conversation with somebody a week back or something, and infrastructure as code doesn't mean that you're just copy pasting a lot of these configuration gambits. You really have to get into the essence of modularity, of reusability. It applies there as well equally. For example, if you're writing Terraform modules, Terraform code, ensure that your Terraform code is also written in a way where it is reusing stuff, because it's code after all, right? You can actually do so much with it. Do not go about copy pasting X number of variables from each section to another section, because that's only going to result in bugs. Spend some thought about actually doing that as well. Policies as code. Now, policies as code is basically, again, all your decisions need to be brought in as a code to a platform. I forgot the name of the tool which Kubernetes has. Saurabh, can you remind me on that? With basically policies coming? Open Policy Agent. What is that called? OPA?
No idea. I know about Terraform Sentinel.
Yeah. So Terraform Sentinel is one way, but that's paid. You can still go ahead and use it. Open Policy Agent is a...
correct. Someone in the audience called it out. Yeah.
Yeah. So that is one thing that is available in the Kubernetes world. Basically, what you're doing is policies are decisions. Decisions get buried outside of the code. If we actually think of any decision that we make, like, hey, a security group should not be, or we should have two NATs across each AZ, or we should have total of 3 replication factor. These are decisions, right? These decisions will not reflect the why part in the code. They will only reflect the how part in the code. And they, if they are available somewhere, they will actually make it easy for anybody to follow it up from later. This sets that culture of transfer of knowledge. So these 3 words, policy as a code, actually has a deeper impact on the culture of the entire team. One other thing that changes and improves this reliability is clear service level objectives. In the previous session, we had this question where we were asking transactions per second and concurrency. A lot of times I've seen that when we define throughput, there's a big confusion around here is, how do we define throughput of a system? When I would go to my business teams and I would ask, what throughput am I designing for? You say 10 requests per minute. Now, 10 requests per minute can be broken down into transactions per second, or is it just mean that if my one request is 1 second, I will have 10 of them. I can literally run them on one single server. I actually don't even need to go HA or anything. If that means that I have a recovery time of 10 seconds, I can still serve those requests. Right now, is that the throughput am I chasing? Or is it that what we're trying to say is that the concurrency is what we're trying to chase? Concurrency is number of, at a given point of time, how many of the given set of requests are open. 10 million users using the same system at the same time is vastly different from 100,000 users using it over a span of 10 over 100 seconds, where each request is 1 second. It's a massive difference in design, because concurrency is going to kill you. Like, it's going to take it to the problems of C10K, the standard problem. And this clear SLO makes it very easy to actually design systems where they fail lesser. And this is something that needs to be cleared upfront. Going further, we say that better tools are the ones which actually avoid failures. But the biggest question is, how do you define what's a tool which is better? Now, all our existing tools that we have around us, you know, like, one of the biggest questions that people get asked is, and I was asked as well, that you guys are site reliability engineers, why do you need to keep building tools every time? You know, like, there are so many tools off the shelf that you can just take. Like, it's just plumbing one X to another pipe and you get your job done. The problem with that is most of our tools are like clever hands. Clever hands is actually an interesting story. So in 1904, there was a horse which used to live in Germany. And there was a claim that hands could do arithmetic. It could actually do computation, floating point algebra calculations as well, and a lot. They first thought it's a hoax. So the owner went around the whole of Germany, taking the horse on a simple exhibition. And they've gotten different evaluators. Turned out that Hans could actually do it. Regardless of the owner, irrespective of who the evaluator was, Hans could actually solve mathematical problems. And simple questions like, somebody will ask Hans, if 10th is a Monday, what is a Friday? Hans would basically show it's 15th. How does Hans show? Hans would either tap on the floor 15 times or wag his tail, and the answer was there. Interestingly, questions could either be asked as written or oral, and Hans would get them. And this used to stump a lot of them. So this actually went into a lot of psychology study as well. So how did Hans do it? The reason Hans could do this was because Hans had learned the idea of reading human emotion. Every time, and how did they validate this? They did a simple experiment. When the observer was in front of Hans where Hans could see, Hans got 95% accurate results. Then they put the observer behind Hans where Hans could not see, and that resulted in 5% accuracy or 6% accuracy. The reason was Hans could read anxiety in humans. No matter who, and if the evaluator knew the answer, Hans knew the answer. If an evaluator didn't know the answer, Hans did not know the answer as well. The reason was Hans would pick it up. Every time the question was asked, Hans would start tapping. The evaluator is bound to get slightly anxious and excited. So by the 14th tap, the evaluator would get anxious and the horse would actually make another one. And then the resting emotion and Hans would stop. Very smart horse. No one knows what happened to him after World War. Last records are 1916. But coming back to the point, most of our tools right now are like clever hands. When I look at Grafana, when I look at my dashboards, I am only looking for things that I know how a system can fail. And obviously, once I know how a system can fail, it will not fail because now I've fixed it. So all those graphs that have been made to catch failures are only there for once, not twice. It's like saying you don't need a parachute to air jump once, you need a parachute to air jump twice. Think about that. So coming back to it, our existing tools limit us. They limit what they offer, and they only show as much as I know, and it won't tell me anything more than that. That's why we need to keep building these tools which actually are able to predict and are able to think more than what we are able to analyze and process. And this is why you would see that the industry is slightly shifting towards, there's a big word going out there that, hey, site reliability engineers actually need a lot of machine learning and rule-based systems. And this is exactly why, because we don't want systems which are just clever hands. Coming back to it, there are no better tools. There's only better usage of the tools. I'm going to go back to asking a bunch of questions, which the reason why we started this talk, I mean, it was written in the description as well, which one is a better tool. So I'm going to ask a question here. Which one do you think is a tool which is better here to use overall?
I wish I could vote on this one.
Okay, go ahead. You can say it. You can influence people.
No. I did not check that option. Well, to be honest, Pulumi is new. Terraform is old.
We see a hand being raised.
Okay. We don't see that.
Tony Verma has raised a hand.
Okay. Can I
you
mute?
Ask
okay.
Q&A? Yeah.
Tony, can you shoot your question if you have any?
I think it was an accidental raise of hand probably.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, no problem.
Cool. I think 5 more seconds and we can stop the poll.
Right.
Okay, interesting results here. I think I can stop speaking. You guys have already gotten the gist of it. 77% people think it depends. 3%, 24% say, total of 3 say that it's Terraform, and nobody has actually voted for Pulumi.
To be honest, I would have said Terraform. Interestingly, because it's that theory that you only, if you know, the only tool you know is a hammer, then everything feels like a nail.
Yeah, and you feel like a Thor. So, yeah, so
Piyush,
before I answer, I want to actually take this tweet. No amount of, and this is just a frustration I was venting a few days back, because we were running bringing up some infrastructure repeatedly, and no amount of Terraform to do we can overcome the fact that if you're bringing up infrastructure repeatedly, there are going to be new failure each time, even on a very well-tested code. This really doesn't eliminate anything. But coming back to how do we choose? Am I going to leave the answer like saying that, look, it just depends, take your pick? No. Here's a framework that we need to evaluate it on. Let's take a design choice here, you know, like carefully. What does Terraform give? What does Pulumi give, right? Pulumi believes in the choice of, look, everything can be used as an SDK. And you can actually write very well code, which is logic, which is deeply complex and gives you insane amount of power that you can actually use. You can write it in Python. You can basically write it in TypeScript. You can actually invoke Golang as well and a couple of other things. And the SDK is available, which is great. However, there's a chance there. There's a catch there. Suddenly, when I'm actually saying that Pulumi does all of this, I'm raising the bar or the entry level of people who can actually get in and actually write those valid configurations. I'm overlooking the fact that Terraform started as a simple DSL. And this is a conversation that Saurabh and I was just having. You know, every DSL lives long enough to not be used or actually evolve into a programming language. But that's what Terraform is doing. You know, the DSL is evolving, but at least it's so very well documented. The use cases are narrowed down. They are marginal. They are lesser. So you can actually just find a lot of cookbooks and recipes out there to actually do that job. But that is not available in Pulumi. But if you are a power user, you will find Terraform very restrictive. So you need to answer this question by yourself, that what is your team made of? What is your culture made of? If you have a team out there which is already very well capable of actually writing these codes and they just want another extension of it, why would you not go with Pulumi? You would. But at the same time, if you think that, look, I have a team which cannot dedicate any time on this, but I really need to get this. This is a skill that I really need to get from the market. You will find it very easily with Terraform, because that's a tool which is battle tested out there, which has been running. Now, with Terraform, there's another. So, do we say that Terraform is better? Not really, because let's say now you've got a bug, right? Now, in Terraform, because it's a DSL, any bug down there, like the simple thing of M into N, M instances and this, you just cannot get this right in Terraform. There's just no way. Now, when you change one, it's either going to add one more disk to the wrong place or it's going to add one more instance incorrectly. You cannot just do a plus or a minus simply. Now, but in the same problem, when you have Pulumi, the onus is on you. It gives you more power. Now, I am responsible for my own bugs. It's just an SDK. And I want to try catch, I can easily. Like the other day itself with Terraform, we ran into an issue. The remote state will not work if there's a third party ARN to be, a role ARN to be used. It just won't work. If I had something like Pulumi, I would have done it better because the code is in my hands. So coming back to it, it really depends. And these are the choices that you will have to make. And there are a bunch of factors that you need to get into. Simple answer being, neither of those two is going to solve the problem if you are not doing it the right way. So it's the usage of the tool. It's not really the tool itself. Similar questions we ask here. Is Ansible greater than Chef? Or is Chef better than Ansible? Not really, because if you have a team which is already very well capable of writing Ruby, then go with Chef. Don't reinvent the entire choice at all. If you have a team which is actually very well capable of writing Python, just go with Ansible. Another question, different choice. Is Prometheus greater than InfluxDB? This takes to a bigger question, which is coming up next. Which one's a better tool?
Piyush, there's a
Elasticity.
poll for
That's the for this one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now this is a poll I want to take here. Elasticsearch and Humayo. A very interesting question that I get asked. And here there's a challenge of when we evaluate this tool, it's also important we understand the breed of that tool. Like Elasticsearch is an index logging system. A Humayo is basically they are the advocates of index-free logging systems. Now, which one of the two would be better? I really want to take index-free logging is basically like I give you a raw system access, syslog, and you have a bunch of greps running on it. As simple as that. And would you rather do those grep or would you rather do those Elasticsearch queries? And okay. I think we can stop the poll. It's been running for a minute.
Right. While the poll is going on, someone has asked a question on chat, Piyush.
Yes.
Are tool wars really the crux of SRE?
That will be answered in the very next slide. Yeah. I think my slides were leaked. So, okay, cool. I think we can just stop the poll.
Okay. Ending poll.
Okay. So 75% people actually believe that index logging is the right thing to be done. 20% believe that index free logging is the right thing to be done. And 7% believe that it depends. I would like to go with the 7%, but Saurav, what do you think? Which one would you prefer?
I would have said index logging primarily because of similar reason, never used Humayo, known enemy Elasticsearch.
Right. So that great point, you know, like I forgot who said this, do boring things. You know, like there's a very famous phrase, do boring things, because a reinvention of these really doesn't help. Do what you know best. You know, like, so if majority of you who have actually been using index logging for a fairly long time, just continue to use that. But at the same time, also be cognizant of the fact that there are going to be inherent challenges that come with every single tool as well. Like Elasticsearch does the job well. There's a massive amount of ecosystem out there. You can set Elasticsearch, then you've got Kibana, then you've got everything around there, right? Works really well. So if it is something that you're very well capable of running, run it. It also depends on what choices that you're running, right? Like example, the footprint that Elasticsearch will run into after a while is going to be massive. Like I haven't seen any one single person who actually has been happy for a prolonged duration of 2 years with Elasticsearch. You know, that's like the expiry time, like where they start complaining, how does this thing scale? So, that's where, you know, like, that's the primary pitch of people like Humayo who say that, look, index free logging doesn't matter how much data you dump in, is simple grep. We will actually just run massively parallel commands and they're going to be fine. So, it also depends on, do you have somebody on your team who's really capable? Like, if you have a team which is massively skilled in Kafka, Humayo would be a natural choice there. You know, like you would say that, look, we already have it. We can actually just plug it into our own Kafka. Now we just need to update the user interface on top and we've got a job done. So again, coming back to a recap and flowing back to the question. When we ask Terraform versus Pulumi, Ansible versus Chef, Prometheus versus InfluxDB, Elasticsearch versus Humayo versus a lot more, what we're really asking here is there's a different layer of reliability of each software. And if you look at the essence of it, there is infrastructure. That's the first layer. And that's the crux of the whole site reliability thing. That this array of tools is going to keep increasing. The answer that I need to give is my infrastructure. If I'm a company which actually deals in infrastructure up and down, I shouldn't be surprised that it's going to fail at some point of time. And I shouldn't assume that this is going to be perennial. This is going to last forever. Build, you know, like I tell people, every time you build a system, build it for a fact that it won't be there tomorrow. What I mean by that is that every single server that you're storing your data on, don't, because it's going to wipe out, it's going to destroy itself when you don't know it, when you're not looking at it. So design your systems in a way where repeatability, idempotency is baked into step every step of the way. And that's really key, idempotency. Because if something can be brought back into its same state where it was, the amount of expenditure that you will have to do, both in terms of money and time, to keep it maintainable is going to marginally drop. Because it's become commodity, right? Like you say that, okay, fine, one machine went away, it doesn't matter, run an infrastructure script again, it will come back. And just frees you up. I do remember that I was once in charge of running these VPNs. And every night at 3:50, VPN would go off every night. I don't know what it was. Maybe we just want some root table which used to actually get flushed or something. And this happened for a month. And then I asked myself, why can't I just automate this thing? And I did. And thereafter, it also used to fail. First, initially in my sleep, I had taught myself a muscle memory, press an enter and would get done. Later, I had actually then designed a small Slack command which would get it done. So you keep automating it. Point being, this is a layer that you need to take care of. Above the infrastructure layer is a configuration management layer. Do not change these things by hand. If you see yourself doing that, stop yourself. Because, I mean, again, you got one or two servers, it doesn't really make a difference. But if you got a massive set of them, it makes a big difference. Because you would remember today, but I mean, to these products, these companies last beyond people, right? What that means is that tomorrow there'll be somebody who you need to pass this information to, or you need to go out and do better things, but somebody still needs to take care of this decision, this policy that goes into that code. Next is a point that I actually bring out is observability. One of the very hyped keywords out there, observability. How do we actually do it? Observability just means that no matter what you use Prometheus, you use InfluxDB, doesn't matter. Ensure that your system is actually observable. What that, and then take a call on what is the right tool for your choice. What that means is, let's say if I'm using I analyze a lot of metrics where I look at trends and spikes every day. Like I really like to look at, is this abnormal for 7 p.m. on a Tuesday night? Is this abnormal for 5 a.m. on a Monday morning? These are the questions that I constantly ask myself. How do I ask myself that question? If I'm building any sort of pattern on it, if I simply run a very small, if nothing but a bell curve analysis, 10 data points, let's say I'm taking data of Monday morning, 5 a.m. How many Mondays exist in a month? 4 or 5, right? Multiplied over a year, they're not going to be that many. You need data over that period to actually do any sort of analysis. Get into this habit that, look, my system should be able to answer my question. And that amount of observability, where you have a curiosity to ask your system these questions, actually both of these tools are going to fail. Because you can keep your entire year's worth of metric, which come in a terabyte a month in InfluxDB or Prometheus both. So you will have to design tools and technologies and strategies which actually go beyond these. So this array is going to expand to a point where you actually might take both of them at a point as well. You say that I need this and I need this as well, because they both solve a different purpose at a different time. Logging, same thing, right? Like logs carry so much valuable information, so much more valuable information, that ask yourself a question that, is my logging even worth it? What am I logging there? Like a lot of times I've seen people, they log information, but what they miss is just a simple thread ID as well. So they can actually not tell which logs connect to what application. So in a concurrent system where there are hundreds and thousands of requests coming in, you won't be able to tell. So it's not which tool do you use for logging, it's the quality of logging as well, which is way more important than the tool of it. What do you do with those logs? Do you analyze them later? Because if they just come in and they go away and you're only going to refer to them when something fails, first of all, by that time, you may not have the right information. Maybe you're not even logging the correlation ID. A lot of time I've seen people actually log really customer sensitive information into those logs as well. The moment we do this habit, there's a price that we're paying of actually ensuring that now our logs have to be very well protected. Each protection comes at its own cost with a different policy, with a different layer around it. So these are the this is the stack that we actually divide reliability into on, and then we pick tools and choices around it, and then we see which one goes with it. But again, the question is not what tool do we use, but what culture do we have around it. Summarizing this in a point, right? Culture will eat tools for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Or if there is not a culture of curiosity and aiming towards reliability, tools are not going to help. They will only assist you in your cause, but the cause has to be there. If I had to summarize this, I would say this is how you attain reliability, or how I have maybe worked for you as well. First, build a culture. Distill that curiosity that, look, failure is going to happen. What can we do along with? There's a very good paper by MemSQL guys, very old paper, where they said that if you go to war, what is the thing that you would actually win with? Assuming that I know it all, assuming I'm the smartest, or the best reaction time. Assuming that you know it all is kind of a fool's fallacy, right? It's never the case. There's always going to be somebody who knows you better than you. Assuming I'm the smartest, never the case as well. You know, like, the definition of all is vast. Smartest obviously is, as a species, we're increasing our intelligence by the day. So not true. Reaction time is the best. Reaction time is...
Piyush, we have some audio. Sorry, I had some audio issues on your end. So maybe
switch off your camera for the time being.
No, that's okay. Everything came through, but there were some issues.
Okay, all right. Am I audible now?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Adopting these tools, embracing a failure, standardization. You know, first thing, yes, let's adopt a tool to our strategy. Standardize it all across. If you have a design decision which you say that, look, I understand this, but this is a compromise I'm making for tomorrow, ensure that you actually standardize it, because then you can come back and fix it very well. Do very frequent and very detailed RCAs. RCAs which just don't say what failed, but also why did it fail and how is it going to improve. Improve this culture by actually sharing this knowledge across the team. Keep this knowledge ready. Don't hide failures. You know, what we have seen is that what we actually do, and early on in our careers as well, we tend to restrict failures to ourselves. That's not really right. And the onus is not on us, but also the one who do you share the failure with. You know, if you're a senior right now in your team running it, build a culture where you actually allow people to come up and look at this fail. Do in-depth analysis of it, brutal analysis of why did it fail? How do we prevent this from happening again? Sometimes those conversations are really, really tough, because a lot of times we are not able to detach person and people from the problem, but one has to do it. So that's a culture that needs to build as well. And last, accept that they're going to be failures. So just a summary, there are going to be failures, they are inevitable. And one important thing here is that we don't learn from success as much as we actually learn from failures. So that's pretty much it. There's a link here as well, which is our fortnightly newsletter, which you can actually subscribe to. We basically are pretty open and vocal about RCAs, and we like to share those.
Cool. That was a very interesting session, Piyush. I think the polls really helped, you know, give weightage to the audience's insights also. Do we have any questions from the audience? You can either paste them in the chat or in the Q&A. While someone calls out the question, I think we can revisit the earlier question, which was, does bad apple theory contradict blameless RCA? I would like to speak to it a little bit. So basically, bad apple theory says that your system will be safe if it were not for those few unreliable people in it. And blameless RCA says that, you know, when you are doing an RCA, don't blame the people, blame the root cause, or find the root cause and find out the tech that is at the base of it. So I would say that bad apple theory sort of lays the foundation for blameless RCA and not contradicts it. Maybe Piyush, you can shed some more light on it.
That's exactly like rightly said here. While it for us to analyze, yes, again, as I said, I keep going back to the same part. are the right skilled people having the right set of ownership? But beyond that, the blameless part is, the question is not who done it. The question is, why will it not happen again? It's not even why did something happen. The very important, I think I learned this from a friend of mine a while back. You know, like, he had this unique way of conducting RCAs. When you approach him with a problem, his first question would be, why do you think this should work in first place? You know, when you ask this very simple question, then when you unravel and you actually go through the layers of, well, this should work because I've done this. Oh, wait, have I done this? You know, like, a very, very simple question to ask. Tell me exactly why do you think this will not fail again? And that's the real thing which actually brings out the essence of blameless RCA and also advances towards making sure that these tools are there, built in the right stride and direction.
It helps. All right, so while questions are coming up, there's one question. How can you try to change the culture in an organization where you are not in a senior position? This is in reference to trying to make the culture more open and shareable shareable with knowledge. So this is mostly around how to influence without authority. Piyush, if you could speak to that.
That's a very tricky question, actually. So why would a culture not change are two reasons, you know. One doesn't know what is the improvement. One doesn't know what is the way to an improvement. I buy into the improvement, I just don't know how to get there. Third is, look, I don't want to improve at all. Now, I don't want to improve at all sounds negative, but the reason behind that could also be, look, don't have time for it right now. We'll come back at it later. And obviously the last, which I don't want to discuss, is where they think it's not worth it, etc. Look, it's not going to happen. So, which is a very toxic one. So let's eliminate that, you know, like, because that's something that you can't change at all. There's literally no way you can actually address the problem where somebody doesn't want to improve despite knowing that I need this improvement, etc., etc. Right. So first part that we said, they don't know what is the improvement. This is where I don't think junior or senior makes a difference, because you can actually very well go in there and educate. Be forthcoming on the fact that, look, I've learned this new thing, this may help. Because a lot of time we just don't know. You know, like, so many things, I learn so many things every single day still, because there are so many things that I just didn't know. And second is, I understand, but I don't know the way to get there. Now, this is where you would actually utilize, you will take an initiative and follow a bit of your off time, your weekends, etc. Come back with proof of concepts and say that, look, I did this and this is how it can be improved, and then see how people follow around it. You know, so, and this is your own growth path as well, because, I mean, you do this X times over, you won't remain a junior. Three is, they understand, like, you're, like, when you said, I'm focusing on the word junior here because you brought it up. You say that, look, we don't want to do this because it's not the right time for it. Valid answer, because maybe what you think is the right thing doesn't fit in the scheme of things here. Like, example, every single reliability stride requires code to be done, more testing to be done, more culture to change. You know, like, somebody will have to change a habit of how they used to do things existingly versus a new pattern that you are suggesting. Now, this requires a bit of adoption as well, where you don't want to bring down an existing system. And while I may have other business goals to chase, the pragmatic thing would be, you take that into consideration, say, fine, we'll come back at it in X months of time. And last one, as I said, if you know you're right, they know you're right, but still they don't want to change, I won't say time to change the job.
All right. So I think we've that has been addressed very, I think I would also want to contribute to that, because I have been in situations wherein the culture was, I was lucky enough to be in situations wherein the culture was directly tied to an automation output. For example, encouraging people to use infrastructure as code. You can show results and move on. But as Piyush rightly said, if everyone knows everyone is right, but nothing is happening, then you have to take the hard way out. All right, one question in the chat, which is, do you think DevOps should have the same limitations of time budget as developer projects? And a follow-up question to that, estimations are challenging since there are too many dimensions and unknowns in tools and versions. So basically what we are trying to say is that, should we, and if yes, how should we do time estimations for DevOps projects also?
Correct. I think I said this in the first talk, and I'll say this again. Reliability has to be seen like a product. It cannot work any other way than a product does. What I mean by that is there are prioritizations in reliability as well. You do not go from 0 to 100. You don't go from 90 to 99.999. It's an incremental step. You can refer to that ladder that I created of the journey of nines earlier. The point being, you take a stab at it. You go incrementally. Let's change few things. Let's set that in motion and then address the next thing. So, and when you look at it like a product, time budgets are always a part of it, because that's the first thing that we do, right? When we do a product sprint planning, we say, these are my tasks of product feature development. This is the cost of it, small, medium, large, etc. Whatever you use, you know, like days, hours, different people have different planning methods. And then that gets rolled out as per a schedule, as per a plan. Even that rollout goes via alpha, beta. You same is the case for reliability as well. And reliability is no different. Reliability doesn't mean you got a new tool and you just deploy it out there. It goes through the exact same cycle of, let's take stab one, 80-20 principles applied all over. What is the least amount of work that I can do, which actually gives me the maximum amount of benefit? Keeping in mind the long-term horizon as well, reusability, every single aspect of software engineering that you've studied or you've read about will actually be applied here as well.
Cool. Okay. So one more question around culture. What should be my strategy around SRE improvements within my organization, like choosing the right tools apart from culture? So basically what strategy to use when evaluating tools?
Again, this is akin to the same problem. How do we choose whether should I use Python or Ruby for my next API? This is a very similar question, right? Because it depends on a lot of factors. One, familiarity. What is my existing team made of? That makes a big difference. Adoption. I understand the like of the benefits that, I mean, I'll cite you an example. This was 2012, I think. I was running, there was a startup that we were doing, and we decided to actually move. We had a, we started hitting certain amount of load, and the root cause analysis that we did was, the reason was that a lot of people would, we were using a dynamically typed language, Python, and a lot of times majority of our bugs were int because of string in case of int, because not valid schemas to be, and 2012 we didn't have these cultures of schema JSON, etc. A long time back, almost a decade from now, back from today. So a lot of this RPCs didn't exist, you know, XML did, but XML was too clunky. So lack of these things would actually ensure that our customers were catching the bugs, which we didn't like at all. So the decision was, what language do we choose? And we zeroed down on a language, Golang. We had the choice of picking up Clojure as well back then. The reason why we picked Golang was because the team that we were all C++ and C developers. We were all familiar with Python. And the choice of introducing an immutable functional paradigm seemed too expensive, no matter how lucrative it was. Drawing a corollary and a parallel here, the same tools go through the same evaluation criteria. What is the team made of? What problem are you solving today and what can be adopted tomorrow? Example, if your immediate, like, let me make it more tangible, while not advocating a tool over the other. If your immediate need is you want to do certain rate analysis, I would say just install a Prometheus. Don't even bother about installing InfluxDB. But at the same time, this is, as I said, every decision is a trade-off. If you're doing some batch analysis of existing data, Prometheus won't help. Because now in Prometheus, you cannot add records with older timestamps. but InfluxDB can do that, right? So these are the requirement that you have, the usage that you have will automatically start driving your tools. What we do is basically we actually create a fishbone kind of thing or an array, a matrix, where we actually plot it down. Very like often we do that. I think we did this yesterday itself. We were supposed to pick up a graph database and we actually ran into this choice of which one should we pick. So we list all the ones down. We draw a dimension of our selection criteria. Query language, ingestion language, durability, how will the customer interact with it, etc. You know, like you lay these down, which are your non-negotiables. As I said, non-negotiables. Put them all down. And then you see which one fares well over the other. Now, in case of a tie-up, in case of a tie where two tools tie with each other, we can decide still. Then we start looking at maintenance and infrastructure cost of it. That what is the footprint that is going to have? In case the footprint is also a tie, then we say that, look, is there a cloud provider available for it which can actually do this, which suffices all my use cases? Then I can just offload my problem. I'm just saying, you know, like multiple segments, that decision fragments that you go through. So something similar, I would suggest that you would go through as well. Probably I took longer to answer the question.
No, I think the, you know, doing the matrix is more useful in scenarios wherein there are opposing views for products. And when you put them on paper, you really substantiate them, give numbers to them. That really helps. Cool.
But okay. Before that, the bigger thing is, what are your non-negotiables? Know those.
Right. Okay. One more question, Piyush. How do you incorporate SRE to data research ML teams where they're working of ways more experimental?
Perfect. Three tools, and because I would say I've been fortunate enough to have worked with on a reliability call with all three of them in one of my previous jobs. Data teams. Actually, reliability in data teams is massively important. We just undervalue the use case of it. I'll tell you why. Data pipeline jobs are mostly asynchronous in nature. The problem with asynchronous is it's like an arrow that has been spent. You cannot reclaim it. You know, it's not like a boomerang who's going to come back.
Right.
If you go through a bad ingestion pipeline, which is 100 of gigabytes, while you're not watching, the data is gone. It has been ingested already into the system. It's very important that you actually build a decent amount of guardrails around quality of data that comes in. Quality of data in terms of, so like we have SLIs and SLOs on request infrastructure, we also have it on data infrastructures, which is how many records came in. After a job was run, how many records were produced? How many records were put in? How long did it take? What was the cardinality of the record set that came out? All these are very important questions and they need to run periodically. How many cores did it consume? Because each one of this is going to give us an answer. Did the data arrive at the same time or not? Did the data exit at the same time or not? Because while these systems are asynchronous in nature, any delay in them is actually going to massively degrade something else which is waiting on it. So that's the data part. Research and ML. Same thing, reliability is important because if somebody is doing experimentation with the data, the quality of the data becomes equally important and what they are changing in an algorithm also becomes important. What that means is if there were certain features that were being extracted in a certain amount of job and a number of features have altered, you need a way to measure it because that instantly tells me that, look, one of my recent pushes has actually degraded the amount of features that were actually being captured with a certain data set. And these are equally going to apply. I mean, I am happy to talk more in this, but I think this is a broader topic or segment. I've given you a very, very high level touch points of what are the things that you do. On SRE book, I think on Google's SRE workbook, the chapter 4 is around something very similar, which is around handling data pipelines. So I would recommend that you actually read that. It's available online. You don't need to buy the book.
Cool. All right. One more question, which is how can we ensure to have SRE in place when we have multiple projects and many of them with different technology stacks like AWS, GCP, or using Ansible Chef? Should we focus on start making small tools around that? Or can we go one by one with projects? I can speak a bit to that because I've
You
been in that
should.
situation. So I worked in a team wherein we used Ansible and Chef both, and not because they were the right tools for the right situation. It was because one guy hated Python, the other guy hated Ruby. So if that is the reason why you are in a situation, then it's mostly a culture thing. However, if you have like, you know, if this, as Piyush had mentioned earlier, standardization on tools is important rather than, you know, getting that 1% of feature. If it is, if you actually have different technology stacks with their valid reasons, like AWS GCP using different Ansible Chef, then in my opinion, you could only build expertise on one thing at a time and deliver it and then move on to the next thing. However, Piyush, if you could speak a little bit to that, that would help.
I don't think I have anything to add to that. You just summarized it really well. So,
okay, cool.
Yeah, all I would say is that in such cases, the need of reliability becomes far more important actually. In heterogeneous environment, reliability has a far bigger role to play than a homogeneous environment. Homogeneity is the result of reliability being applied to heterogeneity. So I would say start yesterday.
Great. Okay, we have a few questions on YouTube also coming in. One of them is, what should be the parameters for an MVP for site reliability? So mostly I think, what are the minimum things that you would need to have if you put in an SRE team in place?
So, I mean, usually I go about first, as I said, the first thing is I put down on paper, what are my non-negotiables? Non-negotiables based on what has been failing. To make it more concrete, there are usual dimensions that you evaluate a system on what can fail. A durability of a system can fail. Correctness of a system can fail. Uptime of a system can fail. Correctness, did I say that already?
Yeah,
correctness, durability, freshness of a system may fail. Now, these are few parameters that you actually classify failures on, and which one's getting affected the most. Which one do you want to fix first? Which is also a very data-driven decision. Which is, so I would say to answer your question, step one, measure it. Measure your failures. What is the impact of each failure that is happening? Classify your failures to find the broadest category of, hey, these 80% of my failures actually belong to the same cause, a 20% category. Example, if most of my failures are about correctness of a data, what that means is, every time I make a request, a like, simple application, let's say we're building Twitter, I make a like and I'm charging people based on number of likes, but when people refresh the page, they don't get the likes. This is freshness of data, right? If this is something which is dear to your business, very first thing that you have to invest is ensure that freshness is always measured. There are the first tool that we'll build is, how do we ensure that the staleness is caught as period one? Second, if you're a payment system, you cannot have incorrectness in the data, or you need uptime in that. These are the first thing that you will face and see if the errors are happening around that. Measure that, fix that. So I would say that this is how you actually start going about building an MVP. Measurability first. So here's the thing, reliability is a three exercise. First is measurability, control, observability. You first measure something, then you control that to actually reduce the errors, to bring it in a bounded state. But to do that, you need a massive amount of observability, and tools that you build actually fall in one of these three buckets. Measurable and observable are actually the same part. So it's a circle that goes.
Cool. Okay. Hope that answers the questions, question Vineet. One more question from Ankur on YouTube, which is, how do you use synthetic monitoring of apps? So this is mostly around the New Relic and all those tooling. Which
do
does
you
that.
Take a stab at that, Saurabh?
Yeah, I mean, I for synthetic monitoring that we do in our case, we mostly try to use New Relic and whatever it provides by default. However, to speak to a broader domain of synthetic monitoring, I think you might have a better perspective on that.
So, I mean, all of these are, I wouldn't say that there is one single choice that I pick over the other. The broader set of classification that goes here is that again, what level of monitoring and what nature of monitoring do I really require is dependent on what failures I've had. So, I mean, I actually don't know how to answer this question. Like, what my view is, yeah, it's good when you need it and where you need it. So maybe a more concrete question I may be able to answer that better.
No, I think it's mostly a question that says, how would you go about it? So I can speak a little more in detail about that, mostly because synthetic monitoring involves trying out customers' paths on a website or an app and seeing how they work, mostly using tool sets for that. However, the good part is that the closer you are to customers, the more behavior you can see, the better your SLOs and all those things can be mapped. That really helps us. However, the sheer number of customers and the spread of them is so much that trying to get a number out of those observations is hard. So yeah, we use synthetic monitoring. It's good.
The fact I'll add there is that there's a limitation. And again, this is, I think, where my answer may look like an endorsement of last night, but I think that does go back into the reason of the reason of being doing this is a lot of, see, why are we doing all of this? To ensure that our customer actually gets the best experience. And if we don't observe a system from outside in on how a customer is going to look at a system or what does it look like and which aspect of it is failing at a very detailed analysis level, like I should be able to tell that, like I'll give you an example. I was speaking with one of the biggest television houses in one of the guys in Netherlands, and a very interesting thought that they had. They said, we deliver videos, but the level of accuracy we need to test is that when a video was delivered, because we have a lot of foreign media coming in, whether the subtitles are actually playing in sync or not as well, because subtitles are usually overlaid. Now, how do they do this? They actually first run simulations on different kind of ISP backbones. They run screen readers where they play a video, and then they actually measure periodically each time when a subtitle was laid, what time frame of the queue of the video was it was, right? Because they are so particular about it. So because it was dear to them, because foreign media content, it really spoils the experience if it is going out of order. Point I'm coming back to is this observability of these systems is massively important, and it requires a great depth of coordination as well. Some of these existing tools that are there out there in the market actually don't help answer that at all. There is nothing out there which can actually connect me from my job of saying that starting right from my browser hitting the CDN till my request hitting my server, where did I actually lose my quality? Or what exactly is it failing? And that is something that I don't know if any synthetic monitoring tools out there are actually capable of even doing it at that level. And that's where site reliability teams step in and have to build a lot of this in-house over and above what they have. But then they run into the problems of vendors don't give out data. You can only do it on their platform. And so you need to build and those databases by yourself as well. I probably took a very long stab at your question.
No, I think that answered the question as well as added new perspectives, and especially the subtitle thing was very interesting. We don't have a question, but I think someone has put out the earlier point of the bad apple theory. I think there is some gap there. Maybe we can try to fill that. Says that the Google SRE theory says that bad apple theory is demonstrably false, directly in correlations to RCS. I think there is a misinterpretation here. I think what we are trying to say is that bad apple theory, what we are essentially trying to say is trust people, and then only will people be more inclined to, fix problems or, attack the problem rather than, he did it versus she did it.
Right. So I think what we are trying to say is bad apple theory doesn't work. What you need to do is, I'm happy to have a chat detailed on this if you still think that there's a misinterpretation here or if any other point was missing.
All right. Okay. I think we are on time plus the questions are done. To sum up, Piyush, I think there is one takeaway that I would like to share with the audience, which I felt was mostly an eye-opener for me, which was when you said that a system's observability is important and the tool that you use for observability is not so important as the system's ability to be observable. So that actually, you know, reminds me of the part wherein whenever we used to write tools, even for any tool that used to go to production, we used to put in unit tests. And someone had told us that unit tests are overrated. You don't need to use unit tests because integration tests could fail, which is true. However, writing code so that it is testable is more important than any discussion around what is the right unit testing framework for it. So the biggest takeaway for me from this talk was Ansible versus Chef, Terraform versus Pulumi is always going to be there. But rather than looking at the next shiny new tool, if I could take whatever I have and work with it and see what limitations it has versus the trade-offs that I get out of it, that I think is the right approach. So that whenever I move to the next tool also, I will at least have extracted everything I need from the current ones.
Sums it up.
Cool. Okay. All right. Thank you everyone for joining in. We will make the slides available post this session. And if you have any other queries, you know Piyush's Twitter handle plus the HasGeek site. And you can also call out at the rate rootconf for #rootconf. That's about it. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, everybody.